do without all the other stuff to get us there. Okay, this is hard. When you got saved, what happened to you? Watch this. Your spirit got recreated. It got born again. Actually, the word that's where it's born again is actually born from above. You're born from another realm. In Hebrews 12, it says, God is the father of your spirit, not your soul, not your body. He's the father of your spirit. Huh? Let me just give you some of these. I can do this real quickly. Now watch this. This is John 3:6. That which Jesus is speaking, that which is born of the flesh is what? It's flesh. You can't do anything else. Flesh only is going to produce flesh. So he says, and that which is born of the Spirit, Holy Spirit, is what? It's Spirit. He only births Spirit. You can't mix those two. Flesh only births flesh. Spirit only births Spirit. So why did you need to be birthed again? Going back to the very beginning. I think I actually have it right here. It doesn't matter. Back in the very beginning, God created man. Remember that? He took the dust. I'm assuming he must have spit in it. How are you going to fashion a man out of dust? I mean, he could have, but I got a feeling he probably spit in it or something, like he did when God came here, right? Why wouldn't he? Anyway, however he did it, he fashioned man out of the dust of the earth, and watch this, it says he breathed into him the breath of life. And what happened? Something happened that had never happened before, ever. And man became a living soul. In the Hebrew, the word breath, spirit, wind are all the same word. They're all the same. He breathed into him the spirit or the breath of God. And when that which was from heaven came into that which was of earth, guess what was created? The soul of man. Never been a soul before. But watch, very quickly, actually in the same chapter, remember God told him, so now in the garden here you can eat any tree you want except the one, because in the day that you eat of that tree, you'll die. Well, we know he didn't die physically, so what did God mean? He did die, but he didn't die physically. Where did he die? Watch this. Died right here. His spirit, the part that God had just breathed into him, died. The connection with him and God is done. It's cut off. Let me see if I can do this. God's intention when he created man, he created us body, soul, and spirit. God created us to inhabit us. He wants to walk in us and live in us, and how he intended to do that was to inhabit your human spirit, that you and him together would communicate with your soul. Your soul was meant to be the servant of your spirit. He would communicate with your soul, and your soul communicates with your body and carries out what the Holy Spirit is saying or doing. That's what God's intention was. It still is. Now, we may not do it good all the time, but you do that every now and then, don't you? You get something from God, and you agree with it in your soul, and you say, okay, I'm going to do that. Well, guess what? It worked. That's what God is after. Okay? So where was I? So there's the connection, God in you. But where was I going to go? Yeah. Let me stop and go somewhere else real quick. Yeah, I'll come back. I'll find my way. Once I start somewhere else, it'll come. Listen to this. 2 Corinthians 5:17. Most of you know it in one of the one of our versions that we use. If any man, what? Be where? In Christ, he is what? A new creation. Actually, it says this. If you go back, I mean, you can translate it that way, but what he's really saying, if any man be in Christ, there, where's there? In Christ. There, in Christ, is a new creation. And in him, where the new creation is, old things have passed away, and behold, all things have become new. Let me read it to you from the Passion Translation. I thought I had it right here. Yeah, here it is. Now, if anyone is enfolded into Christ, he's become an entirely new creation. All that is related to the old order has vanished. Behold, everything is fresh and new. Now, here's where I got tripped up right in the very beginning. When I first came here from Kentucky, I was in prison in Kentucky back in the 70s, and I got paroled up here. I got paroled to Teen Challenge here in Muskegon. And I went there, and I was saved, but barely. His and my experience are totally opposite. He thought the whole thing through. He really did. It took months, but the way it was should be done, and truly understood repentance and really repented. Completely repented, and so his life just exploded. Now, when I heard the gospel, I barely heard it. I barely heard anything. All I knew is whatever the person who was telling me, I knew whatever they had, I wanted. I didn't really pay attention to what they were saying. So you want to pray? Yeah, I want to pray because I want whatever you got. So listen, and I was in prison. And God met me. But all I knew, he forgave my sins. And I'll probably go to heaven. Now, I didn't know anything about you probably shouldn't sin. All I knew is if I do, he'll forgive me. That's all I knew, literally. There wasn't a church in there like there is in prisons here. It wasn't there. And so, I mean, I was barely in. Every now and then I realized, something's different. But I didn't know what or why or any of that, right? So anyway, here's the point. I got saved five months before I got out, got paroled to here. So I'm in Teen Challenge. Their favorite verse in the whole place was 2 Corinthians 5:17. If any man be in Christ, he's a new creation. Old things have passed away. All things become new. And everybody's, they walk around and say it and da-da-da, quote it. And I'm thinking, I must have got the wrong batch of salvation because that ain't true with me. Everything old didn't go away. And everything is not new. I'm serious. I really thought, man, I must have got an inferior quality of salvation. Because that ain't true with me. I could prove it to you. There was still some old stuff. A lot of it, actually. And it wasn't much new. But I'd hear that, and I'd think, I'd feel condemned, kind of not really, I don't know if it was condemned. It felt like, man, am I really in? But what I didn't know then is that a lot of these guys were saying, but that's all. They didn't know anything either. They were saying it, though, like they had something. So here's my point. Here's what I'm going to go right to it this morning. Here's what I want you to know and what I want you to hear. I didn't know what to do. I didn't know how. What do I do with this? It does say that, right? I came to the place where I don't understand that. And I just thought, I don't know. I don't know what I got. But I just disregarded. I just pushed it to the side because I couldn't explain it. It wasn't true of me. Everything wasn't new. It wasn't, period. And old things weren't all gone. So I had to do something with it. I believe it's in the Bible, so I wasn't going to rip it out of the Bible. So I just pushed it over here and just left it alone because I couldn't. And then I found out as it went, there were other things like that. Okay? Now, here's what I want you to know. Hopefully, you don't have to do some of this. What I didn't understand, what I didn't know, which would have answered all these problems, is what happened to me when I did get born again. Because when I understood that, it made everything else, oh, well, of course, in this, choom, 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 choom. So watch, you help me with this. When God created us, He created us a spirit that has a soul that lives in a body. Okay? Well, when you, remember, because you're born of Adam, your spirit's dead. You agree with that? Ephesians 2:1, you were dead in your trespasses and sins. You were dead. Where were you dead? You were walking around. You're dead here. You're dead in your spirit. That was cut off. Now watch, actually, you were a false self. God didn't create you to be that. Your soul was never meant to be in charge. You were in a false position. You were assuming. Now, nobody thought this through. Just listen to what I'm saying. The enemy was behind this, and now the soul of man assumed the position that was meant for his spirit. And now he is a false self because he's living no longer by the life of God, but he's living by purely human life. And he's in charge. That's why we have so much trouble, because you weren't meant to run your own life. Huh? Some of us, it takes a long time to discover that. But you get it? That answers a lot of those problems. Well, no wonder. That's why I'm a mess. Because I wasn't created to do that. Okay, so watch this. So when I heard the gospel and I got born again, let's look at it. What really did happen to me? Did my body get born again? No, my body's still the same, sorry to say. My soul... It changed a little bit because I had to repent. I had to agree with the truth. So in a little itty bit, my soul changed, but very little, right? So what actually happened to me when I got born again? My spirit. Now watch what happened. God resurrected my dead spirit. Not only did He resurrect it, but He recreated it. I'm going to show you what it looks like from the Scriptures. He put the life of God back in me. Not only that, but He put the person of the Holy Spirit in me, in my human spirit. Guess what this package deal is down here? That's a new creation. So much so that when it happened, God sealed it. I haven't got time to explain all this. You can either read it for yourself or something. Look, God, when He did it all, He sealed the deal. He sealed it. Just like if you're canning, why do you seal those jars? Why do you do it, Corrine? Huh? To preserve it so it doesn't, rot and all that, right? Well, when God did what He did with you, He sealed you with the person of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is actually the seal. So He's in and around your human spirit, and you're sealed in there. Now watch, here's what you need to know. This, that new spirit, is the real you. That's a real you. That's the you that died back in the garden, per se, right? It's the real you. The other is a false self. This is why you hear us say over and over and over again, Romans 12:1-2, this is where the problem is at. He tells you what to do. Present your bodies as a living sacrifice to God, holy and acceptable unto God. It's your reasonable service. And do what? Who can? Huh? Come on, you should know this. Come on. Don't any longer be conformed. What's it mean to be conformed to something? You just go along with whatever. Okay, that's how we do it. Okay. He says, no longer be conformed to what? The pattern of what? This world. But be what? Transformed. How? By the renewing of your mind. Because watch, you've got all the old tapes still playing. The old you was died. Not only was it dead, God, it was dead, but He crucified it too. It's doubly dead. It was first dead to God. Now it's really dead. I don't know how else to say it, but He did crucify your old man. Now, I know there's teaching that says otherwise, but you don't have an old man any longer. You can't prove that by the scriptures. Your old man is dead. He's been crucified, buried, buried. That's why you got baptized. This is a brand new you. That's why your mind, watch, even though you're new here, your brain, your mind's still not new until it's renewed. So this is where all your problems are at. You may be new, but you don't believe most of it yet. You hear it, but yeah. So watch this. Here, okay, let me do it like this. So this is new. Your mind is where you hear information. You hear the scriptures taught. You hear about your new identity. But what do you do when you hear about who you really are? Where do you look to get validation for who it says you are? Where do you go look at? Do you look in your body? No. Where, tell me, where do you look at in you to go see if you're new? Yeah, in your soul. You don't know nothing about this yet. So you go look in your soul. You look at your emotions. Well, guess what? They're still the same old emotions that you had. You look in your mind, it's still all the old tapes playing. So you say, well, that can't be right, because this is not all new. Watch, you're looking in the wrong place. Here's where you're new. This is your new identity. This is who you really are. And when I know that, I won't go through all that other stuff. I won't be shocked when I think like this or I do this or do that. I know who I really am. You need to have that revealed to you by the Holy Spirit. Listen, it changes everything. Watch this, especially in this. And if you don't get this, it'll make everything else a mess. You, when you got born again, were made righteous. Not, watch this, most believe you just got declared righteous because what Christ did. That is true, but guess what? Your new born again spirit is righteous with the righteousness of God. Now, whether you can believe it or say it, look, let's do this. Go to Ephesians chapter 4 real quick. Ephesians chapter 4, look down in verse 24. In fact, let's back up to 22. That in reference to your former manner of life, you lay aside the old what? Your old self. The way you behaved, you lay that aside because you're not the old self anymore, which is being corrupted in accordance with the lust of deceit. And what? And that you be renewed in the spirit of your mind and put on the new self. Okay, this is the new self right here. He's telling you put on behavior that's consistent with who you really are. That's what he's trying to tell you. Which is in the likeness of God has been created, what? In righteousness and true holiness. I can give you a number of verses. Now, I know people can struggle with it, but you really are. When Christ came to live on the inside of you, he has become your righteousness. He is in you. He's your righteousness. Watch this, whether you can get a hold of this or not. You are just right now, if you're born again, you are just as righteous as Christ himself is. Here. You say, well, I can't be because, well, yeah, but where are you looking? Right here you are. I'm telling you, if you can get a hold of this, it'll change everything for you. You got to quit looking in the wrong place to validate that. Because if not, you're never going to go anywhere with your identity, because you're going to have all kinds of contrary stuff still in your soul. Watch it. It starts here, and if you'll minister to that, this will grow, and it will eventually work its way up and influence your soul. Didn't you ever think this was strange over in Ephesians 3 in Paul's prayer? He was praying, and he's talking about believers that Christ might, how does it go? Let me see. I always thought this was weird. Watch this. Ephesians chapter 3, it's Paul's prayer, verse 16 and 17. that he would grant you according to the riches of his glory to be strengthened with power through his Spirit, where? In your inner man, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. Well, I thought he was already in you. It's a prayer for the church, right? So why is he praying that Christ may dwell in their hearts? Didn't you find that strange? You can move your head or something if you just one way or the other. Don't you think? I mean, do you or not? I mean, do you think that's a little weird if you're the church and he's praying for you that Christ would dwell in your heart? Huh? Watch. He's here, but he wants to dwell there too. He wants to expand his government, his peace, his person into your soul life, that Christ may dwell in your heart. How? Through faith. I don't need faith for him to live here. He's there whether I believe it or not, right? Is this right? So why would I need faith? I need faith for him to live in my soul. I know this is a little bit whatever for you, but I'm telling you, this is where 90% of the problem is with identity. You got to get it right. You got to realize it's here. This is the real you. And if you start focusing on that, disregard the junk. It's just junk. It's just there until you get your mind renewed. It's just an old tape still playing. The good news is you are there. I'm not getting there. I'm there. But when you get that, that's when rest and peace and all the stuff comes, because, man, I'm not fighting to get there. I'm not hoping I'll be there. I'm there. Here's another one of those truths you have trouble with. The Bible says that you have been accepted in the Beloved. Not many people believe that God really, truly accepts them just like they are. They believe he tolerates them for the most part. Because he knows what I'm like, he definitely doesn't accept me. But watch this. You know why he does? Because he's done this. He's done this. You have been recreated in the image of God, and you are just as acceptable to him as Christ is. Now, I know you have trouble with that, but you got to choose to believe it. I get it. I had all kinds of things with it. But I fought with it and did everything to it until it became a reality to me. I don't fight with it no more. I know. I'm serious. I know. I got it in here. I know it's real. Nobody could ever talk me out of that. You couldn't ever tell me, well, you're not really righteous. It ain't got nothing to do with me. It was a gift. Read it in Romans 5. Who are those how does it go? Not overcome, but they reign in life, or who? Here's who reigns in life. Those who have received the abundance of grace and what? The gift of righteousness. Until you receive it as a gift, you'll never be able to reign in life, because somebody can take it from you. Your experience can change. It's a gift. It's not about being proud, being any of that. No, it's a gift. I received it. He was willing to give it to me. I'm really willing to take it. Listen, everybody in here, you have received it. You have, but you haven't. There's a difference between having something and receiving it. You get see that? You can have something, but you never really received it. You didn't acknowledge it. You didn't say, hey, thank you. I accept this gift. Most of us just, it's there, but we don't acknowledge it. We don't do anything with it, and therefore it doesn't do anything. You don't benefit from it. All right, I guess I don't know what I did. You'll be all right, though. See, when you all don't say anything, I'm not sure where we're at. When you're like, what? I'm not sure if it means you don't know what you're talking about. We don't care. I'm never sure. So I'm not going to go on and on, because to really do this right, it takes time, because I can lay this out for you. Listen, I didn't get this last night. Trust me, I didn't get it yesterday. We will. Listen, guys, I'm telling you, this, most of your problems are right there. You get a hold of that, all, a whole bunch of other stuff will fall in place for you. They just will, won't it? It's true. When you begin to realize who you are, who your real identity is, and know I didn't do nothing, it was a gift given to me. I can't lose it because I didn't do anything to get it. I just received it. It changes everything, doesn't it? Then you can start giving attention to the other things outside of yourself. Because until, you're always going to be worried about you. All right, let me pray for you. Anything else we need to do? Yeah, minister, but I mean, no, nothing else. Okay. All right, any ministry team, why don't you come up, and then I'll pray for us. Now, I'll tell you what, I'm just going to put this out there. You can. But I am more than willing, if people are serious about getting a hold of things like this, I'm more than willing to take the time, whatever time it takes, to help you get it. I really am. That's what I live for. That's what I'm here for. As long as you're serious about it. So I just want to make myself available for that. And I know these guys are too, but I really am. If you're not getting it, and you want to, and you've done all you know to do, I'm more than happy to take the time, however long it takes for you to get that, okay? All right, let me pray for you, and then if you have anything you need prayer for, you can come up, one of us will pray for you. So, Father, I just thank you. I love you. God, I thank you for all that you've done for us in Christ. You call them the unsearchable riches of Christ. We haven't even touched the surface of all that you've accomplished, all that you've done and provided for us. We barely have gotten a hold of it. But I thank you, I thank you, I thank you for all that you've done that we still are waiting to uncover and discover. I just pray, Father, that today what we've spoken, that which was of you, that you would cause it to register on the inside of people, that they'd hear it with the ears of their spirit. They would hear it on the inside, Lord, and they would respond to your voice in it. So I just thank you. I thank you for what you're doing, what you're going to do with us. I love you. We love you. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.